thanking our kind sponsors, Sharon and Arnold Rosenberg, on the occasion of the Shloshim of Sharon's mother, Marat Bela Bas Avram Yitzchak, Belabura Leha Shalom, Nishmasa Aiden. Thank you for the great support of Torah. And again, thank you very much, everyone, for coming. Dr. Abramson.
Tonight, we're going back in time significantly. We started this series with Rashi, because whenever you're learning Torah, of course, you have to start with Rashi. And we're trying to work around some of the major commentators over the first 6 weeks, and then as we move on, we'll explore, God willing, more esoteric commentators as well. But today we're going to look at perhaps the most significant and certainly the most antique of the commentators, and that is Onkelos. Onkelos has a fascinating biography. We only have a few snippets, but they are quite illustrative of a very unusual personality. And he is significant primarily because it's not a commentary that he's written. He wrote a translation. And as Rabbi Teitelbaum will speak about in his half of the presentation, commentary, translation is in itself a commentary. I believe it's Ibn Daud who says, "Show me a translator and I'll show you a liar." Because translations in themselves have to choose one of many different meanings of text, and that in itself is denying the other possible translations of a given word. So Onkelos is always printed on the margin of the text in contemporary Chumashim. It's a translation into Aramaic of the Hebrew text of the Bible, and reading Onkelos is actually a religious requirement far above Rashi and many of the other commentators, as we shall see over the course of the next 45, 50 odd minutes. So let's go straight to his biography. The first thing I have to tell you, and this is, I have to say, a little bit of an anticlimactic statement, we're not sure who Onkelos is. There are two candidates for the title Onkelos. There is a figure who we know popularly as Onkelos, and there's also a figure known as Akila. The reason why these two figures are confused is because in some of our sources we have references to an individual named Onkelos, and others, also equally respectable sources, we have references to a man named Akila doing very similar or identical things in their lives. And so there's a debate among scholars that has raged really since the 4th century as to whether these are two people or one people. You note also, of course, the phonetic similarity of Onkelos and Akila. It's possible that as the stories traveled to Babylon, the Latin term Akila became sort of Babylonianized. That's a real word, I just made it up. They became Babylonianized to Onkelos. But what do we know about them? And as we shall see, there are ways to solve this dispute as well. They're both 2nd century Roman converts to Judaism. They both come from highly influential families, the stories surrounding both of these figures as such. And they are both, of course, great scholars of Judaism who produced very important texts for our purposes. The Babylonian Talmud and the Tosefta, which is an ancient collection of documents similar to the Mishnah, has all these biographical details that refers to Onkelos. And the Babylonian Talmud, as I'm sure many of you are aware, has much more primacy in the Jewish canon than the Jerusalem Talmud, and generally it's studied much more actively, and so the term Onkelos tends to have much more currency as a result. But in the Jerusalem Talmud and in Midrashim that can be dated specifically to Israel, the name used there is Akila. So there's a lot of questions about exactly who are we talking about. The 4th century church father, and it's strange that we have a church father who was involved in this, his name is Epiphanius of Salamis. He was very famous for making processed meat in sort of cylindrical shapes. That has, thank you, I'm glad some people are paying attention. No, I just made that up on the spot, you can tell, spontaneous humor. But Epiphanius of Salamis was a church father who was involved very much in Jewish ecclesiastical history, and he argued that it's the same person. Onkelos and Akila are the same person. Their names were just pronounced differently, and they're confused. It's still a little bit of a question because there are key biographical details that vary, perhaps in type rather than in or perhaps in detail rather than in type, as we shall see shortly. But let's place them in historical context. Both of them lived, or let's just say it's Onkelos, let's say it's one person, will follow Epiphanes of Salamis because we all enjoy good deli. Onkelos lived sometime around the turn of the second century, a period of tremendous conflict and upheaval in Israel. Just to recap some of the major events, in approximately the year 70, you have a disastrous war with the Romans that ends in the destruction of the temple. You have the remnants of a zealot-inspired revolt that has its last stand on the fortress of Masada. You have in the year 135, more or less, another upheaval, another Roman-Jewish war, this time led by Bar Kokhba, that also failed and resulted in phenomenal reprisals from the Roman government under the Emperor Hadrian. It is to this period, the Hadrianic persecution, that we have the story of the Asara Hruge Malchus, the 10 martyrs of the state that we read on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, the Ela Ezkara, Rabbi Akiva's death, and so on. So a really terrible time. We also have phenomenal messianic upheaval. The most significant in the Jewish tradition is, of course, Bar Kokhba himself, who was Bar Kokhba was widely regarded as actually a Mashiach, the Mashiach Yisrael. Rabbi Akiva himself felt that Bar Kokhba was definitely the Mashiach. His colleague said to him, Akiva, your grass will grow from your cheekbones before Bar Kokhba is the Messiah. A very cold statement, which in fact turned out to be the case because Bar Kokhba was defeated by the Romans. We also have another fairly significant messianic movement that did not create such a huge ripple effect in its time, but ultimately would be much more powerful, and that is, of course, the messianic movement surrounding Jesus somewhat earlier in the first century. So this is a period of phenomenal upheaval, tremendous danger for the Jewish polity, and a huge risk for the complete disappearance of the Jewish people as a whole. So, turning to Onkelos himself, according to one version of the story, he was the nephew of Titus, or Titus, shown here. Of course, he is the general who destroyed the temple itself. In this coin, you see how he has a Roman soldier standing over a Jewish soldier who was forced to kneel. This coin is from the year 79. He's also associated with the famous Arch of Titus that commemorates this battle against the Jews and the ultimate subjugation of Israel. And I'm sure you've all seen this very famous bas-relief that is actually sort of on the inside corner here that shows purportedly Jewish slaves taking the menorah under Roman standards off to the Vatican, where it will be, according to some legend, hidden away forever. Hang on, I'll take questions at the end, okay? So this is, according to one version of the story, Titus was his uncle, definitely a very high-level person related to Vespasian, who would become the emperor. According to the other version of the story, his Midrash Tanchuma says that his uncle was actually Hadrian himself, the emperor that persecuted the Jews so severely in the middle of the second century. As the story goes, he went to Israel and was so impressed. He was at the wall and someone went up to him and asked him if he'd like to spend Shabbos, and he ended up getting mekarevd into or Sameach Esha Torah Chabad, the whole thing, and he ended up becoming a ger. There's a fascinating story that I rather enjoy that is recorded in Maseches Avodah Zarah. I was thinking of maybe reading the whole thing through to you, but basically what happens is he becomes converted, and his uncle, whether it's Titus or whether it's Hadrian, very upset with him. This is what they call in Latin ashanda, you know, that he should ashanda for the Yud, and so they send a battalion over there to try and bring him back. And the battalion ends up talking with him, and they're so impressed with everything that he does that in fact they decide to convert too, and they stay there. And so he sends another battalion, and the same thing happens. And the third battalion, he says to them, whatever you do, don't speak with Onkelos. You can't engage in any conversation with him, don't speak with him. And as the story goes, it's not exactly the way it appears in the Gemara, but they walk straight into the base medrash, they pick him up, they walk him out of the base base medrash, as he's walking out, he touches the mezuzah. One of the Roman soldiers says, "What's that?" And it was all over. Heard that joke. But anyways, these are the kind of stories associated with him. There is also an interesting censored account in Gemara Gittin, which is quite fascinating. In the 13th century, not really for our discussion today, but in the 13th century, the church, thanks to the intervention of some Jewish converts to Christianity, the church discovered the Talmud and engaged in quite active study of Talmudic texts and also engaged in heavy interference with the publication and dissemination of the Talmud. Within a couple of centuries, as printing became popularized, the church was also very involved in controlling the actual texts that would be published as Talmudic. So Jewish publishers tended to engage in heavy self-censorship so that these documents would pass the censors' evaluation and they would be able to be published. And so that means there's a whole bunch of material that is missing from our traditional Talmudic texts from about the 13th, 14th century onward until the 20th century. And among those texts, by the way, are preserved in Talmuds that are studied in Muslim lands, and many scholars are able to, bring them back and put them into modern Talmuds or into collections. Anyways, one of those, the kinds of things, by the way, that would be removed tended to be anything that smacked of criticism of Christianity, the biography of Jesus, Rome in particular, anything associated with Rome. It could have been talking about pre-Christian Rome, doesn't matter. The Jewish printers would say it's safer just to take that whole section out. And one of the sections that they took out dealt with Onkelos' own thought process as he was contemplating conversion to Judaism. According to the version that was removed from Gittin, he had kind of a seance and communed with the dead spirits of Bilam and with Jesus and one other famous figure who I can't recall, and he asked them, Vos Tutzach, what's going to happen if I convert to Judaism? And they all said, Svet Gut, it'll be fine if you become Jewish, the Jews are on the right track, and so on. And after communicating with them, he decides to, in fact, become Jewish. Fascinating, and you can see why the Jewish printers would remove that section from the Bible. Titus, the third one. Thank you, Titus. See, this is a very high, Boaz, you're paying attention here? This is like a really high-level class. It's scary for me. The Roman Empire, we also have to place the context of the tremendous pressure that Onkelos must have felt by joining this strange people under these conditions. I just want to take a minute to give you the contextualization of anti-Semitism. I really would like to speak a lot more about this, perhaps maybe Tisha B'Av or something like that. We can have a longer discussion. But scholars have basically identified four distinct ideological periods of anti-Semitism. They're all really quite different. I'm going to give you all four right now, but we'll speak a little bit longer about the Roman period in particular. The first period of anti-Semitism is generally known as classical xenophobia. The word xenos in Greek means stranger. Xenophobia means fear of the stranger, fear of the different. And the Jews were clearly a highly distinctive and unique people in the ancient world, and as a result, a lot of hatred was directed to them. We'll unpack that after we go through the next three very quickly. The second period is early Christian anti-Judaism, and this really evolves in the early second century till about the turn of the millennium. This is essentially a dispute between religious movements. It is born out of the unique mother-daughter relationship of Judaism and Christianity. As Christianity is struggling to identify itself as a separate body of faith, it criticizes somewhat harshly the original faith. As Rosemary Radford Ruther, a very important Protestant theologian, once said, anti-Semitism is the left hand of Christology, by which she meant that as the early Christians wanted to promote Christianity, one of the major tools they had was to demote Judaism at the same time. Just like a daughter striving to achieve her own independence has to somehow criticize her mother in order to emerge from the cocoon of that protective maternal shell. But at this point, early Christian anti-Judaism is largely nonviolent. It's largely ideological. Imagine kind of like debates between rabbis and priests. Those kinds of things go on in this period. The third period is when anti-Semitism kind of goes off the rails, and that's medieval Jew hatred. This is something that begins around the turn of the millennium. It really gets a lot of energy with the 13th century, and this is where certain beliefs that are just completely pathological, the idea that Jews drink Christian blood, that Jews engage in vicarious crucifixions of an imaginary Jesus once a year on Passover, all kinds of bizarre folk ideas sort of imported into anti-Semitism, it becomes much more violent. And as I wrote in one of my articles, it's at this point, by the way, that it tends to change genders as well. Early Christian anti-Judaism, the vocabulary is very much about the female, about women, about representations of ecclesia and synagoga. But once you get to the medieval period, then it becomes about men. And the women who were literally pictured in the center of earlier renditions are actually shunted off to the side. And I'd like to talk more about this, but not tonight. And the fourth period, which we enjoy still today, is a form of anti-Semitism that is born out of the late 19th century. And anti-Semitism as an ideology is quite fascinating because it's somehow like a virus, is able to adapt itself to the unique climate of its host. And it's able to find those kind of like tags to affix itself as a cancerous growth. I'm sorry to use so many medical metaphors when there's so many medical doctors in the room, but the idea is the virus is able to adapt to its circumstances under very uncanny means. So, for example, as religion declines with the Enlightenment, let's say 17th to 18th century, and all of these ideas of like, you know, deicide, killing of God, and of, you know, in league with the devil, and all kinds of things that people no longer take seriously anymore, anti-Semitism becomes secular, and it acquires two distinct characteristics. It becomes very racist in nature, attaching itself to the body of ideas that the Jews constitute a unique race separate from other races. And our genius, by the way, as a race is supposed to be that we are parasites, that we are able to live off other beings until we suck away their energy and you know, move on to a new host. And at the same time with racism, there is the idea of a conspiracy theory, that all Jews are locked together in this conspiracy to enslave Christendom. So those are the four basic periods. But if we focus on our task right now, which is classical xenophobia, none of this was born at this time. The Jews were feared and hated primarily because they were so different from the Romans. And let's place this in the context of Onkelos' conversion. The Romans took off very few days during the year, especially if you were a slave, which was most of the Roman population. You would have off the emperor's birthday, vernal equinox, you know, just a handful of days a year. The Jews were accused of being slothful, lazy, because we took off one day in seven. Can you believe it? One day in seven, we refused to work, we refused to handle money, we refused to engage in commerce. That was just seen as intolerably lazy. We're unproductive kind of people. We were accused of being impious at the same time because we refused to participate in the civic religion of the day. We refused to just perform the very basic obeisances of just bow down to the idol. What's the big deal, you know? Like, if you can imagine going to a baseball game and there's some guy who refuses to stand for the national anthem. Right? There's a lot of criticism directed at that person because just stand up. What's the big deal, right? So we Jews would refuse to do these kinds of things that were markers of basic citizenship in the society. We were accused of being clannish, of refusing to associate with non-Jews because we would not eat with them, we would not drink wine with them, we would not, like, we wouldn't eat their food. We have our own kosher food. We wouldn't drink wine with them because the laws on touching wine that's not completely ruined by boiling. That was a joke too. I thought it was funny. The what was the last thing I was going to say, Boaz? Oh, the, yeah, we, and also, We were accused of being misanthropic, of hating humanity, primarily through circumcision, which was considered such an offense to the Romans, especially because of the Greek love of the human form, the human body. Okay. You know. All right. So imagine this is the kind of environment in which Onkelos converted. It's like converting to be such a misanthropic, clannish, such a complete Yotzei Dofen, off the wall, kind of exceptional, moving in the reverse of everything that the Romans held dear. So placing it in that context, his conversion really takes greater importance. Two details about his personal Yiddishkeit, which are kind of interesting. He was noted for his scrupulosity. This is a word I've been dying to use for at least 2 weeks now since I've been thinking about this lecture. Scrupulosity is actually used by psychologists who treat Jews, Orthodox Jews, with obsessive-compulsive disorder. It's actually a diagnosis because, unfortunately, you know, our religion does include a tremendous amount of details. You know, wash the hands this way, put on the shoes that way, all kinds of things. And people can fall into nebuch, a mental illness, where they're like completely obsessed with doing it exactly mamish right, which in many ways we admire and we represent in a positive light, and as a result it can actually push people further over the edge. So not saying that Onkelos, chas v'shalom, was associated with this, but for example, two things. He tended to be frummer than the rabbis in many ways. He was noted for eating all of his food al taharas ha-kodesh, meaning he would eat it with the same stringencies as if he were a Kohen serving in the temple, meaning he would not allow any food that had even normal defilement that could be consumed by a regular Jew. He would refuse to touch any of it. He would only eat it as if he were a Kohen, even though he was not. He himself, of course, was a convert. And secondly, he had a dispute with Rabbi Gamliel, of all people, who wanted to go to the mikveh in Ashkelon, which is a territory that was traditionally associated with the Philistines and not necessarily part of Israel proper. Onkelos felt that a mikveh on non-Israeli land was not good enough, because it was not, by traditional biblical definition, part of the land of Israel. Even though it was a mikveh there, it would not purify, and he preferred to go into the ocean. He says, Rabbi Gamliel, you can use this mikveh, but I'm going to use the ocean. I don't know if you've ever met converts like that who tend to be more religious than, you know, the rabbis, but it is a known phenomenon. So Onkelos, as an individual, you see he's definitely very contrarian, definitely very principled, but he dedicated his life to the Jewish people, and as a result he has left a phenomenal legacy in his translation of the Chumash. And at this point I want to thank you very much for your attention. I'm going to turn the microphone over to Rabbi Teitelbaum.
Thank you, Dr. Abramson. Good evening again, everyone. We're going to begin with a question. Who wants, with God's help, to live a long life? Good, good. We're almost at 100%. Those with whom we're not, we'll discuss it later. You know, my office hours, you know. So everybody would like to have arichas yamim v'shanim. And this idea of a targum, fascinatingly enough, holds with it the promise for just that. We are introduced to the idea of reviewing the Targum. Now, it doesn't say which Targum, but we'll see in a moment. The Gemara will tell us which Targum it is. Amar Rav Huna bar Yehuda Amar Ravi Ami, La'olam Yashlim Adam Parshiyosef Im HaTzibur. We should be complete in reading all of the Parshios. Im HaTzibur, meaning week by week by week with the Tzibur, the Parsha of the week. Shnayim Mikra Ve'echad Targum. Which may not necessarily have a specific targum attached to them. Shakol hamashlim parshiyos avim hatzibur ma'arichin lo yamav ushnosav. It's going to grant us long life. It's seemingly a part of Talmud Torah to such an extent that it's included in the promise of l'man yirbu yameichem v'mei v'neichem. It's part of that promise that HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, and that we believe in, we daven, we say, Kihem chayenu v'orech yameinu, that's what we will fill our days with, and then they will be long days and blessed years. Now, we have to understand that the idea of doing this, Shnayim Mikra, Echa Targum, needs to be understood on two levels. Why the number three, and why the Targum specifically? Can we fulfill this with any translation or any compilation of commentary? We'll get to that, but let's just focus in on the idea of the three. Shnaya Mikra, Echad Targum, twice the text, once the Targum. The Maral of Prague says, V'yashlomer ki matzino sha Torah nitna bahar Sinai v'nishnais ba'al moed v'nishtal sha ba'arvos moav. He says, look, the Torah was given at Sinai, and then it was taught all over again, and then in Arvos Moav, Haya Be'er HaTorah, Kedichsiv, Ha'ol Moshe Be'er HaTorah. So that's why we have this idea of Shnayim Mikra Echad Targum. The implication of this already is that some kind of a Targum existed even then. That the Targum has origins that go back to the generation that was the Yotzei Mitzrayim and those who came into Eretz Yisrael. How do we know what it is that we mean when we say Targum, that it is our Targum Onkelos? So the Gemara in Maseches Megillah says, Amar Rabbi Yirmiyah, V'isem Rabbi Chiya Bar Abba. Targum shel Torah, Onkelos Hager Amro, Mipi Rabbi Eliezer, Rabbi Yeshua. So we have the dating of the Targum, and we have the authorship of Onkelos as the authoritative Targum. Of course, we know that Rabbi Yeshua and Rabbi Eliezer ben Hyrcanus were, of course, in the generation immediately after Churban Bayis Sheni. Now, the Gemara goes on to discuss, well, we have rayas, we have proofs that this was even more ancient than anything that could have been taught by Rabbi Yeshua and Rabbi Eliezer in the first century, end of the first century. And the Gemara says, you're right, this is Sinaitic in origin. But shakhum, it was forgotten, v'chazru v'yisudum, they were forgotten, and then Onkelos Hager once again brought back somehow the ancient understanding, translation, interpretation of Torah that had been with us, that was extant in the time of Hoel Moshe Be'eres HaTorah. And the question is, how did he do that? Now, some of us can't remember what we ate for what we ourselves ate for breakfast. How does Onkelos Hager come back with what was the original Targum in Aramaic of some 1400 plus years, 1500 years ago?
Ruach HaKodesh.
And that indeed is an interesting answer. Ruach HaKodesh in the times after Churban Bayis Sheni, in the days of the Tanoim. Well, there's an interesting Zohar that gets a little bit of a pump from the idea of saying that, yes, must have been some kind of a Ruach HaKodesh, where the Zohar dates Onkelos to Hillel and Shammai. It's an obscure Zohar that says, Yenuchun Avhan the Alma, they should rest in peace, Hillel and Shammai, the Hachi Amru L'Onkelos, they basically refused to teach him any Torah until he had Bris Mila. So we know that there were these famous stories of Gerim coming to Hillel and Shammai and saying, you know, I want to become a Jew. One of them was Onkelos. That places Onkelos, of course, much earlier, turn of the first century. Well within that period when Ruach HaKodesh, Holy Afflatus, was amongst us and the spirit of Kedusha obtained amongst the Jewish people, Beis HaMikdash was still Kayim. Now, we were mentioning earlier, as Dr. Abramson said, that there's a question about what exactly is Targum meant to be. So it's Onkelos' Targum, that's what we have to read, twice the text, once the Targum. What is it? Is it a translation? Is it an explanation? Is it both? And what do we do practically if we don't understand the Aramis, if we don't understand Aramaic? Halacha in Shulchan Aruch, Halacha Beis, Im Lamad HaParsha BePerish Rashi, Chashuv Kimo Targum. V'yirei Shamayim, Yikra Targum V'gam Perish Rashi. This is the Tours, Psak, codified by the Bais Yosef, originating with the Torah's father, the Rush. Rabbeinu Asher, the great 13th century decisor of Jewish law, laid down a fantastic idea and said, you can't understand Targum, do the Rashi. And that means that the Rush understood Targum to be far more than translation. Obviously, if you're replacing Targum with Rashi, and Rashi is the farthest thing from translation, obviously Targum has in it so much more depth and has a wealth of information. It is not just translation, it's a compilation of meaning and understanding, and that therefore, if we cannot access it, Rashi might be a replacement. Now, there's an important Taz, the Turei Zahav, who says to us, quoting again from the tour, V'kasa v'tur aval im kara b'shar la'az, if you use any other language, which would be the most natural thing to do. English translation. Lo yatza. You're not able to do shnai mikrav echa targum by reading the Chumash, and then English. Not even art scroll.
That's not English anyways.
Sorry. I didn't say that. Yeah. I mean, you can't use any other language because obviously there's an Ruach HaKodesh aspect. You can't replace something which has, first of all of the holy explanation, like Arashi's bringing of Medrash, bringing of the Gemara, all of the holy tradition of what the Pasuk means and what's entailed in understanding the message of the Pasuk, and second of all, in terms of just looking at it as simple translation, if one is Ruach HaKodesh, nothing can replace that. Nothing can replace that. We've begun to discuss this challenge of the Aramaic, and it's important to note that early Rishonim conceded that we have a problem with Aramis. They discuss how clearly there were communities, as we read in the Gemara, every Shabbos, the laning was a pasuk and then a targum, a pasuk and a targum. The cholent, almost as hot, maybe a little cooler, because you would have every pasuk translated by the meturgeman. There was a metargim for every pasuk. What happened to that? What a fantastic idea. Don't tell me that instead the rabbi gives a speech, because we would much rather hear from Onkelos than from the rabbi. The answer is, v'nira, shehem hoyu regilin lefarish lahamon ha'am shehoyu medabrim aramis. It was done because the people understood Aramaic. Aval ledidan, but for us, ma to'eles b'targum, we're not going to read it publicly, kevin she'enonu mevinin oso. And then he says, v'ein Lomar nilmod mehem lefarosh la'am b'loshon sheyavinu. Do not suggest, well then let's read the pasuk publicly out loud from the Torah and then have someone explain it in whatever language we understand. Again, the yesh lomar targum shani shenitkan beruach hakodesh. So you have here the Rishon, the Tur, saying to us, look, that's what the Gemara ultimately means. We understand the Gemara Megillah, which we saw earlier, you know, chazru v'yasdum, that Targum Unklis is that which is based upon the original Sinaitic Be'er HaTorah of the Midbar of the Yotzei Mitzrayim. That's because he was granted Ruach HaKodesh to be able to recompose and reconstitute that ancient Targum.
But the Taz that you had up before said that if you don't understand Russian, you could read it.
Oh, so the Taz says that you can read Perushe HaTorah.
Yeah.
And that, but right, but that's indeed what the Taz says there. He says you can replace even the Rashi, but it would have to be not with a translation, but he says Beferush or Beferushe HaTorah. Correct. Now, we'll move on to something that again indicates to us how unique Aramis really is and why it might be worth our while to struggle through the Aramaic, even to acquire books, translations of the Aramaic. There's a fantastic Hebrew translation of Aramis written by, it just so happens to be an uncle of my father-in-law, Rav Tuvio Wine of Rehovot, composed Yayin HaTov al HaTargumim. But there are, I believe, English translations of the Aramaic and commentary on Targum, so that we can really reacquaint ourselves with the wealth of and the treasure of what Targum is all about. The Zohar says a fascinating thing. The Zohar in Lech Lecha says that the Malachim, the angels in heaven, as we know, shun Aramaic. It's a language that's meant to be uniquely ours, and what we express in that language is not for the ears, if you will, of the Malachim. That's a discussion for another time, why that's so. But the strong language used in the Zohar is that it is ma'us, it's really shunned, it's something that's very, very negative, if you will, in the eyes of the Malachim. And he says, v'hachi itzrich, and that's how it should be. Because this Aramaic Torah, which is Targum, is ours. It's uniquely ours. The less kino lemalachei Eloi b'hadayu di Yisrael yatir, and there's no more envy of the Jewish people. Remember that famous Gemara and the Medrash that says that the Malachim didn't want the Torah to be given to us at all, and the answer was lo b'shamayim hi, it belongs on earth. That's where it's lived. That's where it's practiced. And yet the Malachim are envious. So we have not only the practice of Torah, but the study of Torah in a language that they will not be envious of. So that it is uniquely ours in its study, let alone in its practice. And that study that is uniquely the Jewish study of Torah, that is here on earth, and that is sanctified by the Jewish people in a way that the angels in heaven cannot study, cannot sanctify Torah, is the Aramaic of Echad Targum. Let's take a look at one of the great accomplishments of the Targum. The Rambam in Mor Nevuchim makes a point over and over again telling us how incorporeality, the fact that there is no physicality to the God of Israel, that we believe in a omniscient, all-present, all-knowing Makomo Shel Olam, that is the fill of the universe, that is that the universe takes up a small physical space within the greater non-physical truth that is HaKadosh Baruch Hu. This incorporeality is something which a ger, a proselyte, would want to teach and show again and again and again. So there's a protective measure that the Targum takes anytime there's something that is implying motion, movement, action of a physical kind by HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Targum says, no, 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 let's not translate, let's explain. And you will see in two simple explanations, examples from this past week's Parsha, where revelation takes place before all of the Jewish people at HaSinai. And the Pasuk says, Hinei Anochi Bo Elacha, I'm going to come to you, Ba'av Ha'anon, in the thick cloud. And Targum says, Ha'ano Misgali Lach, I will manifest or be revealed, I'll be experienced prophetically, my presence will be known. But it doesn't say I'm coming, because that kind of a movement, that's a human anthropomorphism that the Onkelos would not even abide in his translation. So it's not a translation. It's a very important kind of explanation, and one pointedly aimed at precluding us from making any kind of mistake about that which he saw all of his life. He doesn't want us to make the kinds of mistakes all the people around him used to make. There are gods that you can imagine, that you can talk to. There are gods you can see. The pantheon of gods, gods you can bow to, gods you can embrace and kiss. No, no, no. That's not the truth. That's not the reality. And he's trying to show that again and again. There's another example in the very next page. Ki bayom hashlishi yered Hashem le'enei chol ha'am al har Sinai. The day of Matan Torah will be a day when God will come down, you know, from the top of the mountain. Yiskele Hashem le'enei chol amo. Altura de Sinai. There is no coming down. There is going to be revelation. There's going to be the vision that we will all have, the experience of Matan Torah. But Onkelos is very protective, the Rambam says, of making sure we don't get any of that wrong, so we have an understanding of the truth of HaKadosh Baruch Hu being Hashem Echad. There are halakhic implications of what it is that's written by Onkelos. And we have here just two out of hundreds and hundreds of instances in Shalos and Chuvis and other Sfarim where people derive from Onkelos's commentary something very practical. The first one by the Chassam Sofer, the great scholar, really the most important, singularly important Jewish scholar of Central Europe of the first half of the 19th century. I mean, his Talmidim and their yeshivos have impacted the Jewish world so greatly. The Chassam Sofer writes in a teshuva where he's discussing the latter part of Mila, after the foreskin has been removed, the small, thin membrane that also has to be pulled back. He says, well, if that wasn't done, would you make a bracha? Because since the Mila hasn't been completed, so you've cut off the foreskin, but you haven't done that priya. And he's discussing this technical issue, and he brings a proof from the Targum on the Pasuk, Umol Hashem Eslavavcha Veslavav Zarecha. Ya'adi, I will remove, not cut. Ya'adi Tipshus Libcha. Removal, he says, is a bona fide understanding of what Mila means. So Mila, Umol Hashem Eslavavcha, doesn't have to mean gzar, cutting. It means revealing that which is otherwise enclosed or hidden. And therefore, for Priya, while the cutting has been done, but that revealing of what lies underneath yet is going to be done, you would make a bracha on that. And he's bringing proof text and support from an Onkelos. Now, it's fascinating that his Rebbe, Rav Nassen Adler, similarly, once said something fascinating about the Aseres HaDibros. Everybody knows that in the Aseres HaDibros, lo tignov means kidnapping. Yet the Torah doesn't say specifically kidnapping. We have a Rashi in Parshas Mishpatim that implies that it includes all kinds of theft. And it would be nice to see in the Ten Commandments that God is saying not only kidnapping, but thievery of any kind is so forbidden and so abhorrent it even has a place in the Ten Commandments. Sure enough, Divrei Yatziv of the Klausenberger Rebbe, he quotes the Sefer Nesina Leger, fascinating name. Nesina Leger, meaning something given or gift to the Ger. The Ger is Onkelos. Nesina is Nassen Adler. That was his name. The great scholar Nassen Adler wrote this Targum to Targum. He wrote a commentary on Targum Onkelos. And he calls it Nesina Leger. And the Klausenberger Rebbe quotes him as saying that, look, you know, when it comes to Lo Sirtzach, it says Lo Tiktol Nefosh. But when it comes to Lo Tignov, it just says Lo Tignuv. And that implies that according to Onkelos, Efshe de Be'emes Sover HaOnkelos Dekoy Gam Magnevas Mamon. V'lachain Nokat Bistama, without Nefosh, without saying a person. He doesn't say theft of a person. He just left it at theft. When it comes to lotir tzach, homicide, he added nefash, the murder of a person. So we are being medayik in Onkelos, where he did add a word versus where he did not add a word, and we're saying, therefore, Onkelos seems to say to us, lotignov is not just technically kidnapping, but any kind of theft is also included in the Aseres HaDibros. So we see that the tremendous amount of study that great scholars engage in when looking at the texts of Onkelos give rise to halachic implications to this very day and have done so really through the ages. Let's conclude with looking at some of the examples of where his translation slash compilation of commentary explanation have really enriched Jewish life, where his meaning to the words have such great ethical and moral implication. We'll have them in order as they appear in the Torah. This is probably the most famous of them all, where in the creation of man, the Torah says, "Vayihi ha'adam l'nefesh chaya," and man was this living being. But no, that which the Onkelos says is so much more important and so much more broad and gives us such insight into the greatness and potential within man, V'havas ba'adam l'ruach mimalala. That is that God's breath manifests, v'havas, God's breath manifests in man, it's given expression through that which man speaks, through the spirit in man, as that spirit comes to expression when a human being verbalizes his thoughts, his aspirations, his hopes, his fears. And that is one of the most important of all of Onkelos's translations, obviously explanations and interpretations of Torah. We'll look at another one that comes from this week's Parsha, Parshas Mishpatim, where the Torah says, if you see your enemy's chamar, your enemy's donkey, roved tachas masa'o, it's breaking down under its tremendous burden, and you need to help the animal, this beast of burden, and the owner of the animal is an enemy of yours. V'chadalta me'azov lo, you would desist from or refuse to help this fellow Jew just because you've got some kind of a disagreement with him. Azov ta'azov imo, help and help again, make sure that the person and the person's animal can be reloaded and safely on their way, says the Targum, something fantastic. You know, in modern Hebrew, if you have some kind of a complaint and you keep airing the complaint and you're complaining and you're complaining, mitloninim, 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 when somebody wants to tell you stop, what will they tell you? Azov. Leave it alone. Tafsik means stop, but to leave it alone means let it go. Azov. So here you have the source for that. You see, because azov, according to Targum, in this pasuk means mishbak tishbok, leave alone madevilibach alohi. Let go of what you have in your heart. Let go of all of that old contentious and negative feeling you have in your heart, whatever it is that you harbor against your fellow Jew, let it go. Utefarekimei, and help him. So that we have a completely novel interpretation of the pasuk, but one that addresses the fact that you really don't like this guy, and you really don't want to help him. And when the Torah repetitively says, azov ta'azov, Targum says, because it doesn't just mean to help, it means azov, let go of, release all of the negative feelings you may have, the resentment that you have, and then ta'azov, go help him. And finally, something that really helps us all. All of us work hard, all of us trying to earn a living, all of us know we can't take credit for our successes. HaKadosh Baruch Hu tells us very pointedly, we have to remember, it's not kochi v'otzim yadi asali esachayel ezeh, it's not because I'm so smart, not because I got my great degree, not because I've worked so hard that I've amassed my fortune or that I'm successful. No, we have to remember, v'zachart es Hashem Elokecha, ki hu hanosin l'cha koach la'asos chayel, because he is the one who gives you the ability, the energy to succeed, to valiantly succeed. Now, you might not be able to read readily into this and say, well, how about somebody who's in business and applies his, you know, great mind and his business acumen and manages therefore to succeed, or practices his or her profession with proficiency, and where in the pasuk does ki hu hanosin l'cha koach la'asos chayel, where does it say that it's about my ability to you know, use my mind well and practice my profession or pursue my business pursuit successfully, says the Targum. And remember, this is Sinaitic in origin, Beruach HaKodesh, in the first century or second century, says Onkelos, Arehu Yahev Lach Eitza Lemikne Nichsin. The Eitza, meaning the ideas, the thoughts that allow you to move on to acquire what you need in life. Lemikne nichsin means to buy what you need, to acquire what you need, to succeed in your business, in your profession. You know what that comes from? The Eitza comes from the higher intellect that's granted the Chachma Bina Das, the Dea Bina Vahaskel, that you daven for in Shemona Esrei, when it's provided by HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that's where and how we can succeed. So we see just from these examples how rich and how important some of the commentary of Targum is, let alone how important it is to recognize it as a basic translation of Chumash, but the accessibility combined with the broad interpretation of Torah that's presented to us through Targum gives us an understanding of how great and important Targum really is and why we try to access it and must try to access it in spite of it being an Aramaic. If the people in the Midbar could do it, we can do it too. Thank you.
Thank you.